Hey, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Dynasty Trade. Hey, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the DLF Trade Show. Still running however many weeks in a row that I made this terrible joke the first time. The best trade show on the DLF YouTube channel. Rock on, Addison. We're still doing it.
We are.
I am your host, Russ Fisher, at Dynasty Outhouse in this horrible, horrible lighting that I need to do something about, but not right now because we're talking trades with Addison Hayes at AmazeHayes underscore. And we are, for the next 2 weeks, going to help you on your, okay, if you agree or disagree with trade deadlines is a completely different show and is a wonderful conversation I will have with all of you for as long as you want. But that's not this show. That's not right now. But we know that trade deadlines are coming up soon. So we want to help you a little bit in that area. So this is going to be a two-parter. This week, we're going to do players to trade for when you're going into a rebuild. And the next week, you guessed it, trades for when you're competing. So today, we are going to look for players that clearly a little bit on the younger side and haven't obtained full value yet. Players you can get at a price that makes you feel happy about it because you like that player, you like having that player on your team, but also that player's value should, I can't say will because don't know the future yet, but there should go up. And that's really what you aim for when you're rebuilding. You aren't always saying, I'm trading for this player. This player is on my team. He's going to be part of my team when I'm ready to compete. You kind of want to get players that will go up in value, and you may have the ability to move for different players that either are further along when you're ready to compete, or if you're not ready to go yet and those players are, you could trade back a little bit. Mm-hmm. But let's just get into it. There's no reason to get super specific without talking about players, which gets even more super specific. Our first player, Tua Tagovailoa. All right, the first trade we have is a 12-team super flex league where Tua comes in at 335.8 on the DLF Trade Analyzer, and he is being traded for Travis Etienne and a 22-second, which total comes in at 270.4 on the analyzer. All day Tua, right? Like, in a super flex league, when you're not getting a quarterback back, you should be overpaying for a quarterback. This is not happening. This is clearly, like, if you don't have Tua in your league, go check to see if the person that does have them is not a Tua believer. Like, maybe they invested in young quarterbacks and maybe they didn't care who they got as long as they were young. Because if someone has them and they're not a believer and you can get Tua for this price, so easy. Like, to me, you have to do this. This is just so easy that I don't know what else to say about it.
100%. I mean, one of the first things, especially in super flex leagues, if you are going through a complete rebuild, one of the easiest and first positions that you should establish is the quarterback position, right? It should be primarily quarterback and wide receivers are the two positions that where you can establish first, because the longevity of value is there and they hold their value year to year more than running backs and even tight ends to an extent. Yeah, especially running back. So grabbing Tua as a QB2 who has the potential, I think, to have back-end QB1 value and production. And we've seen that in a couple games already this year. I mean, just a couple weeks ago, he had like 290 and two, and then he had 320 and four or something like that. Like, he's had pretty solid games. And that was, he still really hasn't had the full weaponry of all of the wide receivers that he was
going to say, wait till he actually gets more than two people to throw the ball to, and maybe he'll even look a little better. And an actual, Gaskins, he looked great last year, not so much this year.
Yeah, so it's just, he still hasn't met his full upside, like you said at the beginning. Like, that's where you can find value in players whenever you are going through a rebuild, and that allows players then to gain value. So I think Tua is a fantastic player to get when you're in a rebuild because he's young. The value is still going to be there. Even if, you know, there is that Deshaun Watson trade, you know, he is going to be involved in the trade to go back to another team. So it's not like he's losing his starting job if Deshaun Watson gets traded to Miami. Miami's not going to do that and sit to it. They're going to have him as a trade piece. So he will be a starter for the, I think, the remainder of his rookie contract at least. And then we start getting into, you know, extensions and stuff like that, but that's fine because that's a couple years down the road, and you know,
exactly,
you're totally good there. So I love this trade for Tua, and I don't really understand the other side, the ETN and the second, because that seems like a rebuilding side as well. But yeah. You know, if you're going for quarterbacks and you're able to pull something like this off, I would 100% do that.
Exactly. Let's move on to this next one. Mm-hmm. Still 12 team super flex. This is 1, 2, 3 22 firsts and Tua for Trevor Lawrence.
Money.
Real talk. What's the big difference between Tua and Trevor Lawrence right now?
Perceived value.
1,000%. That's literally all it is. We want Urban Meyer gone. We want Jacksonville to magically get wide receivers, or at least use the one really good one they have. Correctly. That might not really happen. I mean, Urban Meyer was such a big name. They paid him lots of money. They'll still have to pay him lots of money if they fire him right now. They might ride it out another 1 or 2 years, cross their fingers and hope, and just hope they don't have to pay him as much later on. So that Jacksonville offense might not change too much in the near future. So if you can get someone who's production-wise might be a little better, and at least longevity-wise, they're a year apart age-wise, like, and then three firsts. This is really buying in on the name cachet of Trevor Lawrence, and holy, good for you for getting three firsts in Tua. That's all I can say.
Would you still do it for Tua and two firsts? I'd imagine the answer is yes. Mm-hmm. What about just Tua and a first?
No, because I know I should be able to get more. Whether I agree with it or not, you definitely should. Oh, yeah, so let's... Okay, so Trevor Lawrence comes in at 726.1. Each first is 354.8, and Tua is 335.8. Not doing Tua for a first, by the way, even though that comes out almost exactly even. For a total after the package adjustment of 1258.6. So we are talking a first and a half overpaying on this.
Yeah, I was about to say, like, mathematically... 354 and 335, like, that basically you can just round up to 700, and Trevor Lawrence at 726, like, the value for two and a first for Trevor Lawrence is basically there.
Yeah, so, like, to me, because I was sitting here thinking the right value wise might be to a first and a second. To me, that, at least on this calculator, would even it out a little bit. If I'm the Trevor Lawrence holder, I probably won't do it unless it's Tua and two firsts, just unless that second isn't a pick, it's a player equaling a second that I like.
Yeah.
Yeah. But two and three first. Come on, man. That's that's so money in a rebuild, even though Trevor Lawrence is the golden ticket rebuild. Like, but two and three first is that golden ticket. That's that value you go get, because you can so easily turn all of that into just about anything you want. Mm-hmm. And multiple anythings. Mm-hmm.
I feel like you could just turn those three firsts into another quarterback. You could turn that into, like, Mahomes or Lamar. Anyone. Yeah. And then now all of a sudden you have two quarterbacks.
Yeah. Your quarterback rebuild is done. Tua and, like, Justin Herbert for Trevor Lawrence. That's what just happened.
Yeah.
Like,
you're done.
Yeah. All right. We're going to move on to wide receivers. And this is one that I don't know if we're a week too late on this, because he kind of had his little coming out party.
Sorry.
Yes, we're going to talk about Mike White. No, we're not talking about Mike White. We're talking about Elijah Moore. And this is a player that the draft community has been on from the very beginning. And what was really nice to see was that this past week, when he went crazy for however many yards and two touchdowns, he showed that he's more than just a slot receiver. Like, that was one of the big things. Was like, he's going to come into the league, he's going to be a great slot receiver, but can he be more? More. It's always terrible when talking about people with the last name Moore, because that always ends up happening and you feel like a jerk, but you still giggle about it. Mm-hmm. And I just did all of those things at once. And he showed that he can. Of course, it was only one game, so sample size, blah, blah, blah. But it gives us hope that Elijah Moore is a good piece going forward. and you pulled my trade. That's hilarious. I was about to say I did just trade for Elijah Moore. So this first trade is 12 team super flex, and it is Elijah Moore and a 23 first for Mike Evans. Now this is actually my trade. And
so you traded Evans.
I traded Evans away. Yeah. I have a rebuilding team, and Mike Evans was probably my only player over the age of 25. So I'm like, I want to do something. Let's do something. So I traded him. I went to trade him away. I tried to get a second on top. I'm not going to lie. My original offer was Evans for Elijah Moore, a first and a second, because it was a 23 first and a 22 second.
Okay.
And that got shut down very fast. And I was actually surprised that he did just come back with the first, because I was really expecting Elijah Moore in a second, and then I would have to reject and then offer this. But it came back, and I honestly hit accept right away. I'm just like, yeah, no, that's fine. I could do this. Mm-hmm. And the analyzer pretty much agrees. It is Elijah Moore only comes in at 130.3, a 23 first at 253.3 for package adjustment disc total of 357.2. Mike Evans, 315.7. So, I mean, that's super, super even.
Yeah, no, I love it. And I love that it was your trade as well, because there were a lot of other trades like this one for Elijah Moore. And honestly, what I learned from looking through Elijah Moore trades on the DLF Trade Finder is I need to go out and send some offers for Elijah Moore, because the market on him right now seems really suppressed. And there were other trades like this with other players, replace Mike Evans with Amari Cooper or DeAndre Hopkins, you know, players kind of in that age range and value range, and you kind of get the same type of situation in trade. There were a lot of trades that were like that. And then there are other ones that were just like 222 seconds for Elijah Moore. And it was overall, go trade for Elijah Moore.
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing right now.
Yeah.
So this comes out Thursday. It is now Wednesday. I have some stuff to do before the show comes out.
You do. You have 24 hours, Russ.
Our next trade, is tugging at some heartstrings on me. Elijah Moore, a 22 third, and De'Ami Brown for Chase Claypool. I love me some De'Ami Brown. All right, so here's the thing. The oldest player in this trade is 23. So we got a 21-year-old, 22-year-old, and 23-year-old, and a third-round pick. Mm-hmm. I can be convinced to take either side of this. You know, if I'm... because Claypool, here's the... like, I almost... before we do the show, before we pick what we're going to do, but clearly before Addison puts these show sheets together, we just start listing players. Like, we decided we're going to do the rebuild and competing thing. So we're just like, compete this guy, rebuild this guy. And I almost said Chase Claypool and almost listed, honestly, everyone on the Steelers right now, because it's tough to trust any of them when you're competing, except for maybe Deontay. And we're not talking Najee right now. We're not talking running backs. But Claypool has shown that he can be very good. Unfortunately, the deep threat guy on the Steelers has always been a little boom busty, like going back to like when Manny Sanders was there, Mike Wallace was there. Like, they've always been a little, I almost said Martavis Bryant because hashtag Team Clem's a big wide receiver, but that was a very different reason. if you're not old enough, you don't have to worry about it. So I really do like the idea of Chase Claypool, assuming Pittsburgh, they're getting a new quarterback next year. Even if it's one of the two not great people they have on their team already, there's going to be someone that's not Ben Roethlisberger next year, in which case every single pass catcher gets a bump because Ben is just toast. I mean,
did you watch the Bears game?
I never get to watch all of the night games, but I watched some of it.
There was one play at the end, I think it was in the fourth quarter, where Ben like rolled out of the pocket a little bit, and you know, like a 40-year-old Ben Roethlisberger would, who has a lot of injuries, not like 2010 Big Ben. He like rolled out, and then he like was going to throw the ball deep, and it looked like he had a thought that he's like, I can't get the ball there, and then he was like, you know what, screw it, and he like. James Washington. I think he underthrew James Washington. Like, he had to stop and run backwards and then dive to catch the ball like 30 yards downfield.
And the thing is, like, he threw it like an outfielder throwing it like to home plate. Like, he took five steps, wound up and threw it as hard as he physically could, and it was not great.
It was
so, like, Mason Rudolph, while he is not good at quarterbacking in the NFL, can throw more than 35 yards on his hardest try. So to me, like, it's easily a bump no matter who you go with. But
okay,
I'm going to say, would you be surprised if at the end of the season, Elijah Moore and Chase Claypool were worth pretty much the same?
A little bit.
Yeah.
I would a little bit, because I still think Claypool, the expectation is that no Juju, potentially a new quarterback, we're talking ourselves back into Chase Claypool. And then you have Elijah Moore, who just kind of was like, meh. And I think that he's kind of in the wide receiver 30 to 35 range, and Claypool's up in the high 20s, like he was at the beginning of the year this year.
Okay, that's super fair. I could see that. In which case, this trade is still probably pretty fair at the end of the season, because I do think this is also a little bit biased. I do just really like De'Ami Brown as a player. Plus, chances are Washington is not sticking with Heinicke as their full-on QB going forward, which means they may get a real quarterback in. They may do something else to help that offense out, because they need more than just a quarterback at this point. And I think that could boost him up a little bit. Plus, you know, coming from North Carolina, you don't walk into the NFL and dominate. It takes a little bit, let's just be honest. So maybe he takes his second year step forward. So I could see this trade from either side. It's one of those, if your team is really, really bad and you need to take the risk of splitting up Claypool into two other pieces, I'm cool with this. Or if you have that bad team where you have like 30 meh wide receivers and you want to group two in to go get a guy that you feel a little bit better about, absolutely. And then a third, whatever.
Yeah. I think that I saw this and I thought this was 100% the Chase Claypool side. That's why I included it in here, because this is a rebuilding trade on both sides.
Yeah.
And I would take the Chase Claypool side.
I get it. I absolutely get it, but I could convince myself of both. Let's put it that way. All right, we're going to move on to something I struggled with when Addison brought it up, and that's using a running back in a rebuild, because I have it in my head, no running backs in a rebuild. Oh, you're rebuilding, sell every single running back on your team. You don't even need to have one unless you need to start one, in which case you have a guy who isn't going to score you any points. But he brought up Javonte Williams, and I agreed with it for a couple of reasons. First of all, the dude's 21 years old, so if you can pull off a rebuild in 2 years, the guy will be walking into his prime when you're ready to compete. Mm-hmm. And also, he has the easy opportunity, not just the opportunity, the very likely opportunity that his value will go up well before next season starts.
Tremendously.
Yes, because let's face it, Melvin Gordon likes getting a little nicked up every once in a while, though now that he's splitting touches a lot more, maybe he won't, because we've never really seen him in this much of a split at the end of the season. So we'll see how that goes. But also because Javonte is, at this point in their careers, a little better than Melvin Gordon, but they're still getting a 50-50 split. So there's always a chance that Javonte keeps outplaying him as the season goes on. Maybe Melvin gets a little more tired, and then Javonte just takes it. Or the season ends and every single person convinces themselves Melvin Gordon's gone, this is Javonte's backfield. Or when next season starts, okay, Melvin's just a backup now.
Yeah.
So I completely, again, I was ready to say no right away. But then, okay, no, this guy makes sense and I like it.
Yeah. Probably one of the only running backs that you can actually do this with, you know, that's from the trades that we're about to show, I think actually is cheap enough that you can acquire him on a rebuilding team. And then he gains a lot of value for you heading into next year. But then also, you know, running backs just in general, that's why we don't really like running backs in rebuilds, because they don't really hold their value a whole lot year to year. But when you find these rookies or these young running backs with the expectation that they are going to have a larger workload, you know, you could have done this with Antonio Gibson with the intent of flipping Antonio Gibson in the offseason. You could have done this with Cam Akers before he tore his Achilles. And I think those are the two players that we're going to like, that you can compare Javonte Williams' offseason value increase to, because he was already in that like RB15 kind of range right there with like Joe Mix and Austin Eckler. Like that's where we were already valuing him. But I think at this point, or at like spring and draft season next year, we're going to be talking about Javonte Williams as a borderline top five dynasty running back. And
very likely, yeah.
Yeah, if you can capitalize on, even if you're paying what you consider to be somewhat of a premium now, the return on investment you're going to get later on, if that actually does happen, when that actually does happen, is going to be so beneficial to your team, whether you're competing or rebuilding.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, let's jump into the first trade, which is a 12-team one quarterback, which is very important to remember because Javonte is 530.2 in the analyzer, and he got traded for a first and a second. A first is 354.8, second 113.5, which totals after the adjustment 439.4. Even if you put the just don't do the adjustment, we're talking an extra about 30 points. So about like 470. So that still puts you a late second, early third on the Javonte side. Mm-hmm. And you have to remember, again, this is why I pointed out, it's very important to remember that this is one quarterback, because how many people got drafted before Javonte in a one quarterback league?
Four.
Three to four?
One of five. Yeah.
Exactly. So you will need to pay next year's first plus because you just someone just paid a first this year. Mm-hmm. So only having to add a second to me is just, yes, I will absolutely do this all day.
Yeah, me like, too.
To me, this is so easily the Javonte side.
Would you do two firsts? See, this is where it starts getting
when
hard.
When I stopped and thought about it, yes. No, the answer to me is yes. We are at a point where you can kind of guess playoffs or no playoffs. We're not ready to say early, mid, late. We're ready to say first half, second half. Like, to me, that's where I am, at least.
I think so you can say early and late to a certain degree as well.
Well, yeah, first half, second half, same thing. Yeah, I don't want to say like mid yet, because to me, I'm not ready to say this guy isn't going to make the playoffs, but it's going to be that's getting too specific for where we are yet. But to me, I could say playoffs or non-playoffs and feel sort of okay about it, especially mm-hmm. because chances are, being this close to whatever your deadline is, people have started making those moves. Right. They've started showing their intentions. So if I can say one of them, man, if they're two mids, I would say yes. If it was one early, one late, I would still do it. If it's too early, I would think about it. Like, that would give me pause.
So, like, let's say you're sitting at, what week are we in? If you're sitting at 2-7 going into week 10, would you trade to your first and say you acquired somebody else's first? Who's like 5-4 right now or 6-3. Would you do that? Is your first?
Only no, because it's mine.
Okay.
Because that's rough. Because you're getting your team a little better by getting on Javonte, who is producing. He's not producing enough to give you wins. In which case, if you keep losing and you're handing someone the 101, that doesn't help you in any way, shape, or form. And whether the player that is drafted at the 101 is worth it or not, that pick being the 101 just gains value in everyone's minds. Getting to choose who's going to be there, there's going to be a running back or two that are absolutely going to be worth taking at the 101 coming up. Whether you like them more or less than Javonte is a completely different story. The fact is, I think when it comes down to Javonte or the 101, we would have a very close decision on by itself. Just because it's the 101.
I would have Javonte over the 101, but
I don't know well enough yet, but chances are yes.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I would for sure. But if we're expecting that value increase, like in June or in April, you have the 101. Would you have traded the 101 and another first for Cam Akers?
I'm not in any one quarterback league, so it's really hard for me to say that, but probably, yeah. Like, because, I mean, we're assuming in Superflex that, like, that would have turned into a mid and a late, and you know, probably, yeah.
Yeah. I think you would have, so.
Yeah, I think I would have, too. Okay, so you may have turned me a little bit. I'm just not ready to say it yet, just because, depending on your league, I think you might be able to do a one-for-one swap when you get closer. Let's move on to this much bigger boy. We have Javonte Williams, Chuba Hubbard, and Dalton Schultz. That is a motley crew of players for Saquon Barkley. Mm-hmm. Javonte, 530.2. Chuba, 69.6. Dalton Schultz, 57.6. After the adjustment, which is pretty much Chuba Hubbard, you get a total of 587.74. Saquon Barkley, who was 715.7. I don't feel good about this if I'm the Saquon owner. I'm not going to lie. Oh. Well, I take back everything I just said, because what I was about to say out loud was, would you be surprised if Barkley and Javonte were next to each other in rankings? I'm like, wait, then why wouldn't I want Javonte plus for that?
Right.
I mean, I wish it was more than Chuba and Schultz, especially since this probably isn't tight end premium. And then who cares about Schultz and non-premium, really? But yeah, no, if I think they're going to be back to back, which next year Saquon's going to be 25, which always brings, and a year brings down running back value. Mm-hmm. And people are falling off of Saquon because he keeps getting these stupid injuries. Mm-hmm. But again, have nothing to do with each other. But if we were to see that Saquon's like running back 6 and Javonte's running back 7, would you be surprised by that? No. In which case, if they're right next to each other, why not gain the 3 years, get a couple of players to throw in your bench for depth, and call it a day?
Yep. I highlighted this trade on here because I thought this was one of these perfect ones where this worked for both sides. Like I envisioned the person who has Javonte Williams maybe drafted him a little bit out of luxury and was kind of hoping like, hey, I would be getting like a pretty good RB2 or maybe a potential RB1 by the end of the year, you know, like some sort of like thing like that. And they might not be seeing that yet. And then they kind of had Chuba and they're like, okay, I bought in to Chuba and he got me a couple, you know, spot starts, maybe helped win me a couple weeks because CMC was out, but now CMC's back. Dalton Schultz, you know, whatever. I see this as a competing team on the Javonte side, seeing a couple assets that are about to kind of expire for the year and lose their production value. And then you have Javonte, who's fine, but isn't really giving you what you need. And you move that for Saquon, who, you know, when he comes back next week,
yeah,
the expectation that he's kind of back to being Saquon Barkley, like what we saw before he just twisted his ankle by stepping on a dude's foot.
Seriously.
So I like getting to Saquon Barkley there from a competing side. On the other side, I love moving Saquon Barkley for Javonte Williams. And then you get the additional Chuba Hubbard and Dalton Schultz to throw in there, because Chuba Hubbard is just one of those guys to me that I just want to have on my team because you know that he's the guy if the starter gets hurt. I love those types of running backs. So I love getting Chuba there. I think Dalton Schultz, yeah, it's not premium, but I think that he's a top 10 tight end and you can just start him every week and be fine with it. So I love both sides of this trade. And I don't think that it is, the trade analyzer is as reflective of how close of a trade this actually is.
Yeah, but also we are doing something the analyzer can't and won't do, is
analyze taking situations.
And talking about what's going to happen in 3 months. You know what would make me feel super better about this? If we took those two other small pieces, squished them together, like let's bring it all together. If this was Javonte and Elijah Moore for Saquon, I'd probably feel better about it. And that value works out perfectly between Chuba and Schultz.
I would do that as well. I love that.
Just, okay, that's, I needed to get that out of, to make me feel better. And that's all I care about. Now, all right, let's get to my favorite part. Let's go to horrible trades. A 12-team, one quarterback league. Elijah Moore and Logan Thomas for Zach Ertz. This hurts for many reasons. I had so much Logan Thomas coming into this season.
About to get him back. So,
well, that didn't really help me for the past 8 weeks. He was my guy where if I didn't have one of the top guys, I went after Logan Thomas and that really hurt me. And then I had Gronk and then that hurt me. Tight end was not my position this year. Besides the point, Elijah Moore is 180.6 on the analyzer. If you put Logan Thomas on the other side, it still wouldn't add up to Elijah Moore, because Logan Thomas is 57.2, Zach Ertz 41.4. Now, I get it. Ertz is in a new situation. It's exciting. He's on the Cardinals. They're good. They're fun. No, don't care. You don't just give up value, especially for the point difference you're probably getting between Elijah Moore and Zach Ertz. You can just throw a tight end, it doesn't matter who it is, into your starting lineup as long as you have Elijah Moore in your last flex spot and you feel fine about it.
I thought this trade was funny.
It's
I was like, again, two players better than Zach Ertz for just Zach Ertz. And I love the warning too. Team A is giving up the highest value and the most pieces. I love that warning from the analyzer. I think that's so funny.
Just change it to say not a good move. Yeah, this is not cool, man. Not cool.
Horrible.
Yeah, one might even call it horrible. All right, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our trades to make on a rebuilding team. Hope you gained some knowledge out of this. Hit us up in the comments if you have ideas on other players for rebuilds. We'll give you some ideas on whether we agree you should go for them, or if you should or shouldn't, or what you should or shouldn't be expecting. I'm saying those words too much, so I'm just going to move on. And next week, we're going to come back at you with player trade for when you are competing. And since you know what's coming, we'll see you next time when we do it.
So, Russ, I wanted to have a quick conversation with you and have this like addendum kind of thing that we sometimes do. And on the topic of players that we want to trade for on a rebuilding team, one player that I think could be really interesting and is super sneaky because of the value that he, like the current influx that his value currently is in, is Derrick Henry. Acquiring Derrick Henry on a rebuilding team. I think, you know, that might sound crazy. He's like 27 years old. He is the quintessential, like, ride this guy into the sunset on your dynasty team. Just compete with him as long as you possibly can. But the injury and him being out for most likely the remainder of the regular season, or at least the fantasy regular season, makes it interesting to me that I think that he could be a good asset to acquire if you are rebuilding, similar to kind of what we talked about with Javonte Williams, where his value could probably go up if you get into next season when he's producing again at top five levels. And I think that the price that you can acquire him for right now is super low, because every Derrick Henry team was competing. And they might still think that they are. And like myself, I just made a Derrick Henry trade today, actually.
We made the same trade
to continue competing. Yeah. But I think, so you and I both did Derrick Henry for Darrell Henderson.
Yep.
Just in like literally in a weeks apart. And I think that is an interesting trade on both sides, where I think I see our side, obviously, because we're competing, we want Darrell Henderson. We can't take a zero at our running back slot from Derrick Henry. But then the rebuilding side, who got Derrick Henry, was able to trade an asset who the dynasty community probably sees as descending once the season ends, because Cam Akers is going to return. And then you get Derrick Henry. But I think you could do that for a multitude of other running backs too. Like, I think you could go really low on the running back pull to get Derrick Henry in a one-for-one running back deal. Like, I don't know if you can go like James Conner low, or like potentially get like Cordarrelle Patterson low or Leonard Fournette low. I think that's too low, but I think you can get to some of these other running backs that don't really have long-term value, whereas Derrick Henry might have more long-term value. And that's where you could benefit on a rebuilding team. I don't know how you feel about that.
Okay, here's my issue with this.
If I said a lot of words.
Yeah, it's about damn time.
Sorry.
Why would you say sorry when I said it's a good thing you said a lot of words? I guess that's why you feel weird that you said a lot of words. If you're on a full-on rebuild, I can't back this. Just because there's better options at probably the same price. I would rather go get Dobbins or Etienne if we're talking about full-on rebuild, because to me, they're going to have the same value increase. But here's my thing with Derrick Henry. Why was Derrick Henry so valuable? Besides the fact that he
produced 30 points per game.
So many freaking points. It's because we knew what he was in that offense. The man was a juggernaut. And it didn't matter how many carries he got every season, he didn't get hurt. He's now going to be 28 and coming off of a decent injury.
What if he comes back in the fantasy? What if he's back like in the playoffs, the actual NFL playoffs? You think he's going to get Adam Thielen?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Dynasty value will never again match the production. Never again.
It didn't already, though. Like, that's the
exactly
argument. So that's why I think that you could kind of gain a little bit more value back.
Will there be an increase? Yes. Will there be an increase from what you would pay right now to what you can get before the season starts? 99% yes. But it's a lot of risk. Like, ooh, what happens?
A lot of risk if you get the right price. Like, I'm looking at the trade finder right now. Here's, let me see. Would you do these trades if you are
let's put it this way. We got lucky. I would not do Darrell Henderson.
Oh, wow. You would not?
I would not. I believe in him next year, too.
Okay. Would you do Leonard Fournette, Nelson Agholor, and Randall Cobb?
Yes.
Okay. Would you do Brandon Cooks and Adam Thielen?
No, I'd rather have the receivers.
Oh, man. I don't know about that one.
Oh, right. We're talking about a rebuilding team.
Right.
Yeah. I hate that. I hate that trade so much on a rebuild. Like, go on. Pick another one. Because you shouldn't have any of those players if you're rebuilding.
Right. Would you do... Man, people got some insane deals on Derrick Henry in terms of if they're... Like, people were able to get Aaron Jones for Derrick Henry.
That's crazy.
I call BS on that one. I would not have gotten Aaron Jones. No. No. Would you do Darrell Henderson
going crazy?
Would you do Melvin Gordon and Khalil Herbert?
Yes. Okay, I was wrong. Okay, look, that's really cheap. If you can get him that cheap, like Melvin Gordon and Khalil Herbert is still not even worth a first.
Tyler Boyd and Dalton Schultz.
Oh, Tyler Boyd. But yes. Okay, I take it back. Yeah, you'll be able to sell him at an increase. Just don't expect Derrick Henry 3 weeks ago prices, because I don't think that's going to happen anymore. I don't think, even if he comes back in the postseason and does Derrick Henry in the winter things, I don't think his value gets that high again. But I love it. I love the idea of, I have a bunch of ETN and Dobbins on my teams that are rebuilding. A, because if my team's ready to compete next year, if I make the right moves and the right players do well, I might be able to compete, in which case I have some starting running backs I didn't have before. And the same goes with Derrick Henry. If you're in that retooling phase as opposed to full-on rebuild, I love going to get Derrick Henry, because to me, worst-case scenario, he's a high-end RB2, in which case sending Melvin Gordon for him is still great.
I got two more for you. James Robinson, straight up.
That's tough. I would stare at that for a while. I don't know the answer. On a rebuild, I would aim for something else. That's with Robinson. That's all I could think to say, is because I don't want to do that, but I get it. Because chances are, I was just talking about ETN, the closer he gets to healthy, the lower James Robinson values get. Even though I disagree, I still think Robinson is part of the offense next year.
Mm-hmm. But it's Derrick Henry.
But it's Derrick Henry. Oh, you're the worst today. Yeah, I get it. Yeah. Yeah. All right. I get it. Yeah. But I wouldn't be happy about either side of that. Who else?
Would you trade Ezekiel Elliott for Henry and a first?
Yes.
Okay. Both of those I would say yes to as well.
I mean, getting a first on top, is that puts it pretty far and away. Yeah, I'll do that. Because Zeke is also going to be declining, in which case, how much more than a first is he going to be worth after this year? Mm-hmm. Just because he's already aging, and that Cowboys offense has been a little iffy the past few weeks. So if they don't finish out strong.
Somebody traded Derrick Henry and a second for Melvin Gordon? Oh my gosh. This is fun. Yeah. Derrick Henry for just a second. You would do that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. What's See, like, these yeah. are... This is what I'm talking about. Like, I think that the people who had Derrick Henry
are desperate.
They are desperate. They want that, you know, they want that production back, and they know that they can't get Derrick Henry production back, but they want something because, you know, he was their top five, you know, for sure RB1. And just to be able to recoup a little bit of that and still stay competing, I think is the biggest reason why he makes sense as a player to go out and acquire, if you are rebuilding. And I honestly, when I made the Darrell Henderson trade, the other manager and I were talking and stuff, and he said, hopefully that works out for you and everything. He's like, I just, you know, I'm just ready to go into a rebuild and stuff, because he was 2-7 and I'm 6-3 and in first place. And I said, to be honest with you, I might come back to you about Derrick Henry next offseason. Like, and I would not, like, next offseason, he would decline Derrick Henry for Darrell Henderson 100%. I would 100% have to add to Darrell Henderson to get to Derrick Henry next offseason.
Yeah, most likely.
I 100% would.
Especially if we get good Akers videos coming out.
We already are. Do you see him?
We got one of him running. Let's pump the brakes.
But yeah, so that was an addendum that I wanted to add on here, because I feel like people don't know what to do with Derrick Henry, both the people who have him and the people, like, people are so quick to like, I don't want Derrick Henry. You know, he's going to be like,
I mean, like I just did, and then you convinced me that I was pretty kind of wrong. Yeah, no, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
So if you can acquire Derrick Henry, if you're just sitting on this weird but producing piece as a rebuilding team, you know, and you can try to flip him for Derrick Henry and just see what happens next year. So, but cool. All right.
End your addendum.
Ending. Bye.